United States antitrust law is a collection of federal and state government laws, which regulate the conduct and organization of business corporations, generally to promote fair competition for the benefit of consumers. The main statutes are the Sherman Act 1890, the Clayton Act 1914 and the Federal Trade Commission Act 1914. These acts, first, restrict the formation of cartels and prohibit other collusive practices regarded as being in restraint of trade. Second, they restrict the mergers and acquisitions of organizations which could substantially lessen competition. Third, they prohibit the creation of a monopoly and the abuse of monopoly power. The Federal Trade Commission, the U.S. Department of Justice, state governments and private parties who are sufficiently affected may all bring actions in the courts to enforce the antitrust laws. The scope of antitrust laws, and the degree they should interfere in business freedom, or protect smaller businesses, communities and consumers, are strongly debated. One view, mostly closely associated with the Chicago School of Economics, suggests that antitrust laws should focus solely on the benefits to consumers and overall efficiency, while a broad range of legal and economic theory sees the role of antitrust laws as also controlling economic power in the public interest. History. Although trust has a specific legal meaning, in the late 19th century the word was commonly used to denote big business. Large manufacturing conglomerates emerged in great numbers in the 1880s and 1890s, and were perceived to have excessive economic power. The Interstate Commerce Act of 1887 began a shift towards federal rather than state regulation of big business. It was followed by the Sherman Antitrust Act of 1890, the Clayton Antitrust Act and the Federal Trade Commission Act of 1914, the Robinson-Patman Act of 1936, and the Seller-Kefauver Act of 1950. Indeed, at this time hundreds of small short-line railroads were being bought up and consolidated into giant systems. Advocates of strong antitrust laws argued the American economy to be successful requires free competition and the opportunity for individual Americans to build their own businesses. As Senator John Sherman put it, "If we will not endure a king as a political power, we should not endure a king over the production, transportation, and sale of any of the necessaries of life." Congress passed the Sherman Antitrust Act almost unanimously in 1890, and it remains the core of antitrust policy. The act makes it illegal to try to restrain trade or to form a monopoly. It gives the Justice Department the mandate to go to federal court for orders to stop illegal behavior or to impose remedies. Public officials during the Progressive Era put passing and enforcing strong antitrust high on their agenda. President Theodore Roosevelt sued 45 companies under the Sherman Act, while William Howard Taft sued 75. In 1902, Roosevelt stopped the formation of the Northern Securities Company, which threatened to monopolize transportation in the Northwest. One of the more well-known trusts was the Standard Oil Company. John D. Rockefeller in the 1870s and 1880s had used economic threats against competitors and secret rebate deals with railroads to build what was called a monopoly in the oil business, though some minor competitors remained in business. In 1911, the Supreme Court agreed that in recent years Standard had violated the Sherman Act. It broke the monopoly into 36 separate companies that competed with one another, including Standard Oil of New Jersey, Standard Oil of Indiana, Standard Oil Company of New York, of California, and so on. In approving the breakup, the Supreme Court added the rule of reason: not all big companies, and not all monopolies, are evil. And the courts are to make that decision. To be harmful, a trust had to somehow damage the economic environment of its competitors. United States Steel Corporation, which was much larger than Standard Oil, won its antitrust suit in 1920 despite never having delivered the benefits to consumers that Standard Oil did. In fact, it lobbied for tariff protection that reduced competition, and so contending that it was one of the good trusts that benefited the economy is somewhat doubtful. Likewise, International Harvester survived its court test, while other trusts were broken up in tobacco, meat packing, and bathtub fixtures. Over the years, hundreds of executives of competing companies who met together illegally to fix prices went to federal prison. One problem some perceived with the Sherman Act was that it was not entirely clear what practices were prohibited, leading to businessmen not knowing what they were permitted to do, and government antitrust authorities not sure what business practices they could challenge. In the words of one critic, Isabel Patterson, as freak legislation, the antitrust laws stand alone. Nobody knows what it is they forbid. In 1914, Congress passed the Clayton Act, which prohibited specific business actions if they substantially lessened competition. At the same time, Congress established the Federal Trade Commission, whose legal and business experts could force business to agree to consent decrees, which provided an alternative mechanism to police antitrust. American hostility to big business began to decrease after the Progressive Era. For example, Ford Motor Company dominated auto manufacturing, built millions of cheap cars that put America on wheels, and at the same time lowered prices, raised wages, and promoted manufacturing efficiency. Ford became as much of a popular hero as Rockefeller had been a villain. Welfare capitalism made large companies an attractive place to work. New career paths opened up in middle management. Local suppliers discovered that big corporations were big purchasers. Talk of trust busting faded away. Under the leadership of Herbert Hoover, the government in the 1920s promoted business cooperation, fostered the creation of self-policing trade associations, and made the FTC an ally of respectable business. During the New Deal, likewise, attempts were made to stop cutthroat competition, attempts that appeared very similar to cartelization, which would be illegal under antitrust laws if attempted by someone other than government. The National Industrial Recovery Act was a short-lived program in 1933, €35 designed to strengthen trade associations and raise prices, profits and wages at the same time. The Robinson-Patman Act of 1936 sought to protect local retailers against the onslaught of the more efficient chain stores by making it illegal to discount prices. To control big business, the New Deal policymakers preferred federal and state regulation, controlling the rates and telephone services provided by American Telephone and Telegraph Company, for example, and by building up countervailing power in the form of labor unions. By the 1970s, fears of cutthroat competition had been displaced by confidence that a fully competitive marketplace produced fair returns to everyone. The fear was that monopoly made for higher prices, less production, inefficiency and less prosperity for all. As unions faded in strength, the government paid much more attention to the damages that unfair competition could cause to consumers, especially in terms of higher prices, poorer service, and restricted choice. In 1982, the Reagan administration used the Sherman Act to break up AT&T into one long-distance company in seven regional baby bells, arguing that competition should replace monopoly for the benefit of consumers and the economy as a whole. The pace of business takeovers quickened in the 1990s, but whenever one large corporation sought to acquire another, it first had to obtain the approval of either the FTC or the Justice Department. Often the government demanded that certain subsidiaries be sold so that the new company would not monopolize a particular geographical market. In 1999, a coalition of 19 states and the Federal Justice Department sued Microsoft. A highly publicized trial found that Microsoft had strong-armed many companies in an attempt to prevent competition from the Netscape browser. In 2000, the trial court ordered Microsoft split in two to punish it and prevent it from future misbehavior. However, the Court of Appeals reversed the decision, removed the judge from the case for improperly discussing the case while it was still pending with the media. With the case in front of a new judge, Microsoft and the government settled, with the government dropping the case in return for Microsoft agreeing to cease many of the practices the government challenged. In his defense, CEO Bill Gates argued that Microsoft always worked on behalf of the consumer and that splitting the company would diminish efficiency and slow the pace of software development. Cartels and collusion. Preventing collusion and cartels that act in restraint of trade is an essential task of antitrust law. It reflects the view that each business has a duty to act independently on the market, and so earn its profits solely by providing better priced and quality products than its competitors. The Sherman Act, Section 1, prohibits, e, very contract, combination in the form of trust or otherwise, or conspiracy, in restraint of trade or commerce. This targets two or more distinct enterprises acting together in a way that harms third parties. It does not capture the decisions of a single enterprise, or a single economic entity, even though the form of an entity may be two or more separate legal persons or companies. In Copperweld Corporation v. Independence Tube Corporation, it was held an agreement between a parent company and a wholly owned subsidiary could not be subject to antitrust law, because the decision took place within a single economic entity. This reflects the view that if the enterprise has not acquired a monopoly position, or has significant market power, then no harm is done. The same rationale has been extended to joint ventures, where corporate shareholders make a decision through a new company they form. In Texaco Incorporated v. Dow, the Supreme Court held unanimously that a price set by a joint venture between Texaco and Shell Oil did not count as making an unlawful agreement. Thus, the law draws a basic distinction between concerted and independent action. Multi-firm conduct tends to be seen as more likely than single-firm conduct to have an unambiguously negative effect and is judged more sternly. Generally, the law identifies four main categories of agreement. First, some agreements such as price fixing or sharing markets are automatically unlawful, or illegal per se. Second, because the law does not seek to prohibit every kind of agreement that hinders freedom of contract, it developed a rule of reason, where a practice might restrict trade in a way that is seen as positive or beneficial for consumers or society. Third, significant problems of proof and identification of wrongdoing arise where businesses make no overt contact, or simply share information, but appear to act in concert. Tacit collusion, particularly in concentrated markets with a small number of competitors or oligopolists, have led to significant controversy over whether or not antitrust authorities should intervene. Fourth, vertical agreements between a business and a supplier or purchaser up or downstream raise concerns about the exercise of market power, however they are generally subject to a more relaxed standard under the rule of reason. Restrictive practices. Some practices are deemed by the courts to be so obviously detrimental that they are categorized as being automatically unlawful, or illegal per se. The simplest and central case of this is price fixing. This involves an agreement by businesses to set the price or consideration of a good or service which they buy or sell from others at a specific level. If the agreement is durable, the general term for these businesses is a cartel. It is irrelevant whether or not the businesses succeed in increasing their profits, or whether together they reach the level of having market power as might a monopoly. Such collusion is illegal per se. United States v. Trenton Potteries Company, 273 U.S. 392 per se. Illegality of price fixing, Appalachian Coals, Incorporated v. United States, 288 U.S. 344. United States v. Socony Vacuum Oil Company, Incorporated, 310 U.S. 150. Bid rigging is a form of price fixing and market allocation that involves an agreement in which one party of a group of bidders will be designated to win the bid. Geographic market allocation is an agreement between competitors not to compete within each other's geographic territories. Edyston Pipe and Steel Company v. United States pipe manufacturers had agreed among themselves to designate one lowest bidder for government contracts. This was held to be an unlawful restraint of trade contrary to the Sherman Act. However, following the reasoning of Justice Taft in the Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court held that implicit in the Sherman Act A Section 1 there was a rule of reason, so that not every agreement which restrained the freedom of contract of the parties would count as an anti-competitive violation. Hartford Fire Insurance Company v. California, 113 SCT 2891 5-4, a group of reinsurance companies acting in London were successfully sued by California for conspiring to make U.S. insurance companies abandon policies beneficial to consumers, but costly to reinsure. The Sherman Act was held to have extraterritorial application, to agreements outside U.S. territory. Group boycotts of competitors, customers or distributors, Fashion Originators Guild of America v. FTC, 312 U.S. 457. The FOGA, a combination of clothes designers, agreed not to sell their clothes to shops which stocked replicas of their designs, and employed their own inspectors. Held to violate the Sherman Act A Section 1, Clause, Incorporated v. Broadway Hale Stores, Incorporated, 359 U.S. 207. A group boycott is per se unlawful, even if it may be connected with a private dispute, and will have little effect upon the markets, American Medical Association v. United States, 317 U.S. 519, Molina's v. National Basketball Association, 190 F. Sup. 241, Associated Press v. United States, 326 U.S. 16-3, a prohibition on members selling spontaneous news violated the Sherman Act, as well as making membership difficult, and freedom of speech among newspapers was no defense, nor was the absence of a total monopoly. Northwest Wholesale Stationers v. Pacific Stationery, 472 U.S. 284. It was not per se unlawful for the Northwest Wholesale Stationers, a purchasing cooperative where Pacific Stationery had been a member, to expel Pacific Stationery without any procedure or hearing or reason. Whether there were competitive effects would have to be adjudged under the rule of reason. NYNEX Corporation v. Discon, Incorporated, 525 U.S. 128. The per se group boycott prohibition does not apply to a buyer's decision to purchase goods from one seller or another. Rule of reason. If an antitrust claim does not fall within a per se legal category, the plaintiff must show the conduct causes harm in restraint of trade under the Sherman Act A Section 1 according to the facts peculiar to the business to which the restraint is applied. This essentially means that unless a plaintiff can point to a clear precedent, to which the situation is analogous, proof of an anti-competitive effect is more difficult. The reason for this is that the courts have endeavored to draw a line between practices that restrain trade in a good compared to a bad way. In the first case, United States v. Trans-Missouri Freight Association, the Supreme Court found that railroad companies had acted unlawfully by setting up an organization to fix transport prices. The railroads had protested that their intention was to keep prices low, not high. The court found that this was not true, but stated that not every restraint of trade in a literal sense could be unlawful. Just as under the common law, the restraint of trade had to be unreasonable. In Chicago Board of Trade v. United States, the Supreme Court found a good restraint of trade. The Chicago Board of Trade had a rule that commodities traders were not allowed to privately agree to sell or buy after the market's closing time. The reason for the Board of Trade having this rule was to ensure that all traders had an equal chance to trade at a transparent market price. It plainly restricted trading, but the Chicago Board of Trade argued this was beneficial. Brandeis J., giving judgment for a unanimous Supreme Court, held the rule to be pro-competitive and comply with the rule of reason. It did not violate the Sherman Act A Section 1. As he put it, every agreement concerning trade, every regulation of trade, restrains. To bind, to restrain, is of their very essence. The true test of legality is whether the restraint imposed is such as merely regulates and perhaps thereby promotes competition or whether it is such as may suppress or even destroy competition. To determine that question, the court must ordinarily consider the facts peculiar to the business to which the restraint is applied, its condition before and after the restraint was imposed, the nature of the restraint, and its effect, actual or probable. Broadcast Music v. Columbia Broadcasting System, 441 U.S. 1. Blanket licenses did not necessarily count as price fixing under a relaxed rule of reason test. Arizona v. Maricopa County Medical Society, 457 U.S. 332. 4-3 held that a maximum price agreement for doctors was per se unlawful under the Sherman Act Section 1. Wilk v. American Medical Association, 895 F2D 352. The American Medical Association's boycott of chiropractors violated the Sherman Act A Section 1 because there was insufficient proof that it was unscientific. United States v. Tofco Asics, Incorporated, 405 U.S. 596, Palmer v. BRG of Georgia, Incorporated, 498 U.S. 46, Broadcast Music, Incorporated v. CBS, Incorporated, 441 U.S. 1, National Socky of Professor Engineers v. United States, 435 U.S. 679. A paragraph 219-220, NCAA v. Board of Regents of the University of Oklahoma, 468 U.S. 85 7-2, held that the National College Athletics Association's restriction of television of games, to encourage live attendance, was restricting subtly, and therefore unlawful. California Dental ASSN v. FTC, 526 U.S. 756, FTC v. Indiana Fedon of Dentists, 476 U.S. 447, Tacit Collusion and Oligopoly. Matsushita Electric Industrial Company, Limited v. Zenith Radio Corporation, 475 U.S. 574, held that the evidence needed to show unlawful collusion, contrary to the Sherman Act, must be enough to exclude the possibility of individual behavior. Bell Atlantic Corporation v. Twombly, 550 U.S. 544 5-2, while Bell Atlantic and other major telephone companies were alleged to have acted in concert to share markets and not compete in each other's territory to the detriment of small businesses, it was held that in absence of evidence of an agreement, parallel conduct is not enough to ground a case under the Sherman Act. A Section 1, Interstate Circuit, Incorporated v. United States, 306 U.S. 208, Theater Enterprises v. Paramount Distributing, 346 U.S. 537, no evidence of a legal agreement, however film distributors gave first film releases to downtown Baltimore theaters, and suburban theaters were forced to wait longer. Held, there needed to be evidence of conspiracy to injure, United States v. American Tobacco Company, 221 U.S. 106, found to have monopolized the trade. American Tobacco Company v. United States, 328 U.S. 781, after American Tobacco Company was broken up, the four entities were found to have achieved a collectively dominant position, which still amounted to monopolization of the market contrary to the Sherman Act. A Section 2, American Column and Lumber Company v. United States, 257 U.S. 377, Information Sharing, Maple Flooring Manufacturers ASSN v. United States, 268 U.S. 563, United States v. Container Corporation, 393 U.S. 333, Airline Tariff Publishing Company, Settlement with the U.S. Department of Justice, Vertical Restraints. Resale Price Maintenance, Dr. Miles Medical Co. v. John D. Park and Sons, 220 U.S. 373, Kiefer Stewart Company v. Seagram and Sons, Incorporated, 340 U.S. 211. It was unlawful for private liquor dealers to require that their products only be resold up to a maximum price. It unduly restrained the freedom of businesses and was per se illegal. Albrecht v. Herald Company, 390 U.S. 145, setting a fixed price, minimum or maximum, held to violate Section 1 of the Sherman Act. State Oil Company v. Kahn, 522 U.S. 3, vertical maximum price fixing had to be adjudged according to a rule of reason. Legion Creative Leather Products, Incorporated v. PSKS, Incorporated, 551 U.S. 877, 5-4 decision that vertical price restraints were not per se illegal. A leather manufacturer therefore did not violate the Sherman Act by stopping delivery of goods to a retailer after the retailer refused to raise its prices to the leather manufacturer's standards. Outlet, territory or customer limitations, Packard Motor Car Company v. Webster Motor Car Company, 243 F2D 418, 420, cert, denied, 355 U.S. 822, Continental Television v. GTE Sylvania, 433 U.S. 36 6-2, held that it was not an antitrust violation, and it fell within the rule of reason. for a seller to limit the number of franchises and require the franchisees only sell goods within its area. United States v. Colgate and Company, 250 U.S. 300. There is no unlawful action by a manufacturer or seller who publicly announces a price policy and then refuses to deal with businesses who do not subsequently comply with the policy. This is in contrast to agreements to maintain a certain price. United States v. Park, Davis and Company, 362 U.S. 29. Under Sherman Act A Section 4, Monsanto Company v. Spray Rights Service Corporation, 465 U.S. 752, stating that, under Colgate, the manufacturer can announce its resale prices in advance and refuse to deal with those who fail to comply, and a distributor is free to acquiesce to the manufacturer's demand in order to avoid termination. Monsanto, an agricultural chemical, terminated its distributorship agreement with Spray Right on the ground that it failed to hire trained salesmen and promote sales to dealers adequately. Held, not per se illegal, because the restriction related to non-price matters, and so was to be judged under the rule of reason. Business Electronics, Incorporated v. Sharp Electronics, Incorporated, 485 U.S. 717. Electronic calculators, mergers. Although the Sherman Act 1890 initially dealt, in general, with cartels and monopolies, it was recognized that this left a gap. Instead of forming a cartel, businesses could simply merge into one entity. The period between 1895 and 1904 saw a great merger movement as business competitors combined into ever more giant corporations. However, upon a literal reading of Sherman Act, no remedy could be granted until a monopoly had already formed. The Clayton Act 1914 attempted to fill this gap by giving jurisdiction to prevent mergers in the first place if they would substantially lessen competition. FTC v. Dean Foods Company, 384 U.S. 597. 5-4, the FTC was entitled to get an injunction to prevent the completion of a merger between milk-selling competitors in the Chicago area before its competitive effects are determined by a court. Robertson v. National Basketball Association, 556 F2D 682. Injunction issued against merger of the NBA with the ABA, Citizen Publishing Company v. United States, 394 U.S. 131. Failing company defense, Cargill, Incorporated v. Monfort of Colorado, Incorporated, 479 U.S. 104. Private enforcement, Clayton Act 1914 A Section 8, Interlocking Directorates, Horizontal Mergers. Northern Securities Company v. United States, 193 U.S. 197. Horizontal Merger under the Sherman Act, United States v. Philadelphia National Bank, 374 U.S. 321. The second and third largest of 42 banks in the Philadelphia area would lead to a 30% market control, and so violated the Clayton Act A Section 7. Banks were not exempt even though there was additional legislation under the Bank Merger Act of 1960. United States v. Vons Grocery Company, 384 U.S. 270. A merger of two grocery firms in the Los Angeles area did violate the Clayton Act A Section 7, particularly considering the amendment by the seller Eurokefauver Act 1950. United States v. General Dynamics Corporation, 415 U.S. 486. General Dynamics Corporation had taken control over, by share purchase, United Electric Coal Companies, a strip mining coal producer. Horizontal Merger Guidelines, FTC v. Staples, Incorporated, 970 F Sup 1066, Hospital Corporation of America v. FTC, 807 F2D 1381, Federal Trade Commission v. H.J. Heinz Company, 246 F3D 708, United States v. Oracle Corporation, 331 F Sup 2D 1098, Vertical Mergers. United States v. Columbia Steel Company, 334 U.S. 495, United States v. E.I. DuPont and Amores and Company, 351 U.S. 377, Brown Shoe Company, Incorporated v. United States, 370 U.S. 294. There is not one single test for whether a merger substantially lessens competition, but a variety of economic and other factors may be considered. Two shoe retailers and manufacturers merging was held to substantially lessen competition, given the market in towns over 10,000 people for men's, women's and children's shoes. Conglomerate mergers. United States v. Sidney W. Winslow, 227 U.S. 202, United States v. Continental Can Company, 378 U.S. 441. Concerning the definition of the market segments in which the Continental Can Company was performing a merger. FTC v. Procter & Gamble Company, 386 U.S. 568, Monopoly and Power. The law's treatment of monopolies is potentially the strongest in the field of antitrust law. Judicial remedies can force large organizations to be broken up, be run subject to positive obligations, massive penalties may be imposed, and all the people involved can be sentenced to jail. Under A Section 2 of the Sherman Act 1890, every person who shall monopolize, or attempt to monopolize, any part of the trade or commerce among the several states commits an offense. The courts have interpreted this to mean that monopoly is not unlawful per se, but only if acquired through prohibited conduct. Historically, where the ability of judicial remedies to combat market power have ended, the legislature of states or the federal government have still intervened by taking public ownership of an enterprise, or subjecting the industry to sector-specific regulation. The law on public services and administration goes significantly beyond the realm of antitrust law's treatment of monopolies. When enterprises are not under public ownership, and where regulation does not foreclose the application of antitrust law, two requirements must be shown for the offense of monopolization. First, the alleged monopolist must possess sufficient power in an accurately defined market for its products or services. Second, the monopolist must have used its power in a prohibited way. The categories of prohibited conduct are not closed, and are contested in theory. Historically, they have been held to include exclusive dealing, price discrimination, refusing to supply an essential facility, product tying and predatory pricing. Monopolization. Northern Securities Company v. United States, 193 U.S. 197 5-4, a railway monopoly, formed through a merger of three corporations, was ordered to be dissolved. The owner, James Jerome Hill, was forced to manage his ownership stake in each independently. Swift & Company v. United States, 196 U.S. 375. The antitrust laws entitled the federal government to regulate monopolies that had a direct impact on commerce. Standard Oil Company of New Jersey v. United States, 221 U.S. 1. Standard Oil was dismantled into geographical entities given its size, and that it was too much of a monopoly. United States v. American Tobacco Company, 221 U.S. 106, found to have monopolized the trade. United States v. Alco, 148 F2D 416. A monopoly can be deemed to exist depending on the size of the market. It was generally irrelevant how the monopoly was achieved, since the fact of being dominant on the market was negative for competition. United States v. E.I. DuPont and Amores and Company, 351 U.S. 377, illustrates the cellophane paradox of defining the relevant market. If a monopolist has set a price very high, there may now be many substitutable goods at similar prices, which could lead to a conclusion that the market share is small, and there is no monopoly. However, if a competitive price were charged, there would be a lower price, and so very few substitutes, whereupon the market share would be very high, and a monopoly established. United States v. CFI Enterprises, 903 F2D 659. Necessity of barriers to entry, Lorraine Journal Company v. United States, 342 U.S. 143. Attempted monopolization, United States v. American Airlines, Incorporated, 743 F2D 1114, Spectrum Sports, Incorporated v. McCullen, 506 U.S. 447. In order for monopolies to be found to have acted unlawfully, action must have actually been taken. The threat of abusive behavior is insufficient. Fraser v. Major League Soccer, 284 F3D 47. There could be no unlawful monopolization of the soccer market by MLS where no market previously existed. United States v. Griffith, 334 U.S. 104. Cinema corporations secured exclusive rights from distributors, foreclosing competitors. Specific intent to monopolize is not required, violating the Sherman Act or millisecond section 1 and 2. United Shoe Machinery Corporation v. U.S., 347 U.S. 521. Exclusionary behavior, United States v. Grinnell Corporation, 384 U.S. 563. Grinnell made plumbing supplies and fire sprinklers, and with affiliates had 87% of the Central Station Protective Service market. From this predominant share there was no doubt of monopoly power. Exclusive dealing. Standard Oil Company v. United States, 337 U.S. 293. Oil supply contracts affected a gross business of $58 million, comprising 6.7% of the total in a seven-state area, held to be contrary to Clayton Act A Section 3, Tampa Electric Company v. Nashville Coal Company, 365 U.S. 320. Tampa Electric Company contracted to buy coal for 20 years to provide power in Florida, and Nashville Coal Company later attempted to end the contract on the basis that it was an exclusive supply agreement contrary to the Clayton Act A Section 3 or the Sherman Act A millisecond Section 1 or 2. Held that this did not affect competition sufficiently. U.S. v. Delta Dental of Rhode Island, 943 F. Sup. 172, Price Discrimination. Rabin Sauna Euro Patman Act, Clayton Act 1914 A Section 2, FTC v. Morton Salt Company. Volvo Trucks North America, Incorporated v. Reader Simcoe GMC, Incorporated. J. Truett Payne Company v. Chrysler Motors Corporation. FTC v. Henry Brock and Company. FTC v. Borden Company, Commodities of Light Grade and Quality, United States v. Borden Company, The Cost Justification Defense, United States v. United States Gypsum Company, Meeting the Competition Defense, Falls City Industries v. Banco Beverage, Incorporated. Great Atlantic and Pacific Tea Company v. FTC, Essential Facilities. Aspen Skiing Company v. Aspen Highlands Skiing Corporation, 472 U.S. 585. The refusal of supply access to ski slopes violated the Sherman Act Section 2. Eastman Kodak Company v. Image Technical Services, Incorporated, 504 U.S. 451. Kodak has refused to supply replacement parts to small businesses servicing Kodak equipment, which was alleged to violate the Sherman Act A millisecond Section 1 and 2. The Supreme Court held 6-3 that the small businesses were entitled to bring the case, and Kodak was not entitled to summary judgment. Verizon Communications v. Law Offices of Curtis v. Trinco, LLP, 540 U.S. 398. No extension of the essential facilities doctrine beyond that set in Aspen, Otter Tail Power Company v. United States, 410 U.S. 366, Berkey Photo, Incorporated v. Eastman Kodak Company, 603 F2D 263, United States v. AT&T led to the breakup of AT&T, tying products. Sherman Act 1890A Section 1, covers making purchase of goods conditional on purchase of other goods, if there is sufficient market power. International Business Machines Corporation v. United States, 298 U.S. 131. Requiring a leased machine to be operated only with supplies from IBM was contrary to Clayton Act A Section 3. International Salt Company v. United States, 332 U.S. 392. It would be a per se infringement of the Sherman Act A Section 2 for a seller, who has a legal monopoly through a patent, to tie buyers to purchase products over which the seller does not have a patent, United States v. Paramount Pictures, Incorporated, 334 U.S. 131. Hollywood Studios' practice of requiring block booking was unlawful, among other things, Times Picayune Publishing Company v. United States, 345 U.S. 594 5-4, where there was no market dominance in a product market, tying the sale of a morning and an evening newspaper together was not unlawful, United States v. Laurie's Incorporated, 371 U.S. 38 product bundling and price discrimination. The existence of a tie was sufficient to create a presumption of market power. Jefferson Parish Hospital District No. 2 v. Hyde, 466 U.S. 2 reversing Lowe's, it was necessary to prove sufficient market power for a tying requirement to be anti-competitive, United States v. Microsoft Corporation 253 F3D 34 and District Court. Microsoft ordered to be split into two for its monopolistic practices, including tying, but then the ruling was reversed by the Court of Appeals. Predatory pricing. In theory, which is hotly contested, predatory pricing happens when large companies with huge cash reserves and large lines of credit can stifle competition by engaging in predatory pricing. That is, by selling their products and services at a loss for a time, in order to force their smaller competitors out of business. With no competition, they are then free to consolidate control of the industry and charge whatever prices they wish. At this point, there is also little motivation for investing in further technological research, since there are no competitors left to gain an advantage over. High barriers to entry, such as large upfront investment, notably named sunk costs, requirements in infrastructure and exclusive agreements with distributors, customers, and wholesalers, ensure that it will be difficult for any new competitors to enter the market, and that if any do, the trust will have ample advance warning and time in which to either buy the competitor out, or engage in its own research and return to predatory pricing long enough to force the competitor out of business. Critics argue that the empirical evidence shows that predatory pricing does not work in practice and is better defeated by a truly free market than by antitrust laws. Brook Group Limited v. Brown and Williamson Tobacco Corporation, 509 U.S. 209. To prove predatory pricing, the plaintiff must show that changes in market conditions are adverse to its interests, and that prices are below an appropriate measure of its rival's costs, and the competitor had a reasonable prospect or a dangerous probability of recouping its investment in the alleged scheme. Weyerhaeuser Company v. Ross Simmons Hardwood Lumber Company, 549 U.S. 312. A plaintiff must prove that, to make a claim of predatory buying, the alleged violator is likely to recoup the cost of the alleged predatory activity. This involved the sawmill market. Barry Wright Corporation v. ITT Grinnell Corporation 724 F2D 227, Spirit Airlines, Incorporated v. Northwest Airlines, Incorporated, 431 F3D 917, United States v. E.I. DuPont and Amores and Company, 351 U.S. 377, Intellectual Property. Continental Paper Bag Company v. Eastern Paper Bag Company, 210 U.S. 405 8-1, concerning a self-opening paper bag, it was not an unlawful use of a monopoly position to refuse to license a patent's use to others, since the essence of a patent was the freedom not to do so. United States v. Univis Lens Company, 316 U.S. 241. Once a business sold its patented lenses, it was not allowed to lawfully control the use of the lens by fixing a price for resale. This was the exhaustion doctrine. International Salt Company v. United States, 332 U.S. 392. It will be a per se infringement of the Sherman Act A Section 2 for a seller who has a legal monopoly through a patent to tie buyers to purchase products over which the seller does not have a patent. Walker Process Equipment, Incorporated v. Food Machinery and Chemical Corporation, 382 U.S. 172 illegal monopolization through the maintenance and enforcement of a patent obtained via fraud on the patent office case, sometimes called Walker process fraud. United States v. Glaxo Group Limited, 410 U.S. 52. The government may challenge a patent where it is involved in a monopoly violation. Illinois Tool Works Incorporated v. Independent Inc., Incorporated, 547 U.S. 28. There is no presumption of market power, in a case on an unlawful tying arrangement, from the mere fact that the defendant has a patented product. Apple Incorporated Litigation and United States v. Apple Incorporated. Scope of antitrust law. Antitrust laws do not apply to, or are modified in, several specific categories of enterprise and for several kinds of actor. First, since the Clayton Act 1914a Section 6, there is no application of antitrust laws to agreements between employees to form or act in labor unions. This was seen as the Bill of Rights for Labor, as the Act laid down that the labor of a human being is not a commodity or article of commerce. The purpose was to ensure that employees with unequal bargaining power were not prevented from combining in the same way that their employers could combine in corporations, subject to the restrictions on mergers that the Clayton Act set out. However, sufficiently autonomous workers, such as professional sports players, have been held to fall within antitrust provisions. Second, professional sports leagues enjoy a number of exemptions. Mergers and joint agreements of professional football, hockey, baseball, and basketball leagues are exempt. Major League Baseball was held to be broadly exempt from antitrust law in Federal Baseball Club v. National League. Holmes J. held that the baseball league's organization meant that there was no commerce between the states taking place, even though teams traveled across state lines to put on the games. That travel was merely incidental to a business which took place in each state. It was subsequently held in 1952 in Tulson v. New York Yankees, and then again in 1972 Flood v. Kuhn, that the baseball league's exemption was an aberration. However, Congress had accepted it, and favored it, so retroactively overruling the exemption was no longer a matter for the courts, but the legislature. In United States v. International Boxing Club of New York, it was held that, unlike baseball, boxing was not exempt, and in Raider Veitch v. National Football League, professional football is generally subject to antitrust laws. As a result of the AFL-NFL merger, the National Football League was also given exemptions in exchange for certain conditions, such as not directly competing with college or high school football. However, the 2010 Supreme Court ruling in American Needle Incorporated v. NFL characterized the NFL as a cartel of 32 independent businesses subject to antitrust law, not a single entity. Third, antitrust laws are modified where they are perceived to encroach upon the media and free speech, or are not strong enough. Newspapers under joint operating agreements are allowed limited antitrust immunity under the Newspaper Preservation Act of 1970. More generally, and partly because of concerns about media cross-ownership in the United States, regulation of media is subject to specific statutes, chiefly the Communications Act of 1934 and the Telecommunications Act of 1996, under the guidance of the Federal Communications Commission. The historical policy has been to use the state's licensing powers over the airwaves to promote plurality. Antitrust laws do not prevent companies from using the legal system or political process to attempt to reduce competition. Most of these activities are considered legal under the Noah Pennington Doctrine. Also, regulations by states may be immune under the Parker Immunity Doctrine. Professional Real Estate Investors, Incorporated, v. Columbia Pictures, 508 U.S. 49, Allied Tube v. Indian Head, Incorporated, 486 U.S. 492, FTC v. Superior CT. TLA, 493 U.S. 411, 4th, the government may grant monopolies in certain industries such as utilities and infrastructure where multiple players are seen as unfeasible or impractical. 5th, insurance is allowed limited antitrust exemptions as provided by the McCarran-Ferguson Act of 1945. United States v. Southeastern Underwriters Association, 322 U.S. 533. The insurance industry was not exempt from antitrust regulation. Credit Suisse v. Billing, 551 U.S. 264 7-1. The industries regulated by the Securities Act 1933 and the Securities and Exchange Act 1934 are exempt from antitrust lawsuits. Parker v. Brown, 317 U.S. 341. Actions by state governments were held to be exempt from antitrust law, given that there was no original legislative intent to cover anything other than business combinations. Goldfarb v. Virginia State Bar, 421 U.S. 773. The Virginia State Bar, which was delegated power to set price schedules for lawyers' fees, was an unlawful price fixing. It was no longer exempt from the Sherman Act, and constituted a per se infringement. California Retail Liquor Dealers ASSN. B. Midcol Aluminum, Incorporated, 445 U.S. 97. The state of California acted contrary to the Sherman Act 1890A Section 1 by setting fair trade wine price schedules. Rice v. Norman Williams Company, 458 U.S. 654. The Sherman Act did not prohibit a California law which prohibited the importation of goods that were not authorized to be imported by the manufacturer. Treatant International Corporation v. Commonwealth of Kentucky, 467 F3D 547. Kentucky had not acted unlawfully by giving effect to a tobacco master settlement agreement, because there was no illegal behavior in it. United States v. Trans-Missouri Freight Association, 166 U.S. 290. The antitrust laws applied to the railroad industry, even though there was a comprehensive scheme of legislation applying to the railroads already. No specific exemption had been given. Silver v. New York Stock Exchange, 373 U.S. 341. The New York Stock Exchange was not exempt from antitrust regulation, even though many of its activities were regulated by the Securities and Exchange Act 1934. American Society of Mechanical Engineers v. Hydrolevel Corporation, 456 U.S. 556 6-3. That the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, a non-profit standard developer, had violated the Sherman Act by giving information to one competitor, used against another. Banks and agricultural cooperatives. Remedies and enforcement. The remedies for violations of U.S. antitrust laws are as broad as any equitable remedy that a court has the power to make, as well as being able to impose penalties. When private parties have suffered an actionable loss, they may claim compensation. Under the Sherman Act 1890A Section 7, these may be trebled, a measure to encourage private litigation to enforce the laws and act as a deterrent. The courts may award penalties under a millisecond Section 1 and 2, which are measured according to the size of the company or the business. In their inherent jurisdiction to prevent violations in future, the courts have additionally exercised the power to break up businesses into competing parts under different owners, although this remedy has rarely been exercised. Three levels of enforcement come from the federal government, primarily through the Department of Justice and the Federal Trade Commission, the governments of states, and private parties. Public enforcement of antitrust laws is seen as important, given the cost, complexity, and daunting task for private parties to bring litigation, particularly against large corporations. Federal government. The federal government, via both the Antitrust Division of the United States Department of Justice and the Federal Trade Commission, can bring civil lawsuits enforcing the laws. The United States Department of Justice alone may bring criminal antitrust suits under federal antitrust laws. Perhaps the most famous antitrust enforcement actions brought by the federal government were the breakup of AT&T's local telephone service monopoly in the early 1980s and its actions against Microsoft in the late 1990s. Additionally, the federal government also reviews potential mergers to attempt to prevent market concentration. As outlined by the Hart-Scott-Rodino No Antitrust Improvements Act, larger companies attempting to merge must first notify the Federal Trade Commission and the Department of Justice's Antitrust Division prior to consummating a merger. These agencies then review the proposed merger first by defining what the market is and then determining the market concentration using the Heerfindahl-Hirschman index and each company's market share. The government looks to avoid allowing a company to develop market power, which if left unchecked could lead to monopoly power. Federal Trade Commission v. Sperry and Hutchinson Trading Stamp Company, 405 U.S. 233. The FTC is entitled to bring enforcement action for businesses that act unfairly, as where supermarket trading stamps and coupons were prohibited from being traded among the holders. The FTC could prevent the restrictive practice as unfair, even though there was no specific antitrust violation. State governments, state attorneys general may file suits to enforce both state and federal antitrust laws. Perrins Petrae, Hawaii v. Standard Oil Company of Cal, 405 U.S. 251. State governments do not have a cause of action to sue for consequential loss for damage to their general economies after an antitrust violation is found. Private suits, private civil suits may be brought, in both state and federal court, against violators of state and federal antitrust law. Federal antitrust laws, as well as most state laws, provide for triple damages against antitrust violators in order to encourage private lawsuit enforcement of antitrust law. Thus, if a company is sued for monopolizing a market and the jury concludes the conduct resulted in consumers being overcharged $200,000, that amount will automatically be tripled, so the injured consumers will receive $600,000. The United States Supreme Court summarized why Congress authorized private antitrust lawsuits in the case Hawaii v. Standard Oil Company of Cal, 405 U.S. 251, 262. Every violation of the antitrust laws is a blow to the free enterprise system envisaged by Congress. This system depends on strong competition for its health and vigor, and strong competition depends, in turn, on compliance with antitrust legislation. In enacting these laws, Congress had many means at its disposal to penalize violators. It could have, for example, required violators to compensate federal, state, and local governments for the estimated damage to their respective economies caused by the violations. But this remedy was not selected. Instead, Congress chose to permit all persons to sue to recover three times their actual damages every time they were injured in their business or property by an antitrust violation. By offering potential litigants the prospect of a recovery in three times the amount of their damages, Congress encouraged these persons to serve as private attorneys general. Pfizer, Incorporated v. Government of India, 434 U.S. 308. Foreign governments have standing to sue in private actions in the U.S. courts. Bigelow v. RKO Radio Pictures, Incorporated, 327 U.S. 251. Treble damages awarded under the Clayton Act A Section 4 needed not to be mathematically precise, but based on a reasonable estimate of loss, and not speculative. This meant a jury could set a higher estimate of how much movie theaters lost when the film distributors conspired with other theaters to let them show films first. Illinois Brick Company v. Illinois, 431 U.S. 720. Indirect purchasers of goods where prices have been raised have no standing to sue. Only the direct contractors of cartel members may, to avoid double or multiple recovery. Mitsubishi Motors Corporation v. Solar Chrysler Plymouth, Incorporated, 473 U.S. 614. On arbitration theory, the Supreme Court calls the Sherman Antitrust Act a charter of freedom, designed to protect free enterprise in America. One view of the statutory purpose, urged for example by Justice Douglas, was that the goal was not only to protect consumers, but at least as importantly to prohibit the use of power to control the marketplace. We have here the problem of bigness. Its lesson should by now have been burned into our memory by Brandeis. The curse of bigness shows how size can become a menace, both industrial and social. It can be an industrial menace because it creates gross inequalities against existing or putative competitors. It can be a social menace. In final analysis, size in steel is the measure of the power of a handful of men over our economy. The philosophy of the Sherman Act is that it should not exist, industrial power should be decentralized. It should be scattered into many hands so that the fortunes of the people will not be dependent on the whim or caprice, the political prejudices, the emotional stability of a few self-appointed men. That is the philosophy and the command of the Sherman Act. It is founded on a theory of hostility to the concentration in private hands of power so great that only a government of the people should have it. Dissenting opinion of Justice Douglas in United States v. Columbia Steel Company. By contrast, efficiency argue that antitrust legislation should be changed to primarily benefit consumers, and have no other purpose. Free market economist Milton Friedman states that he initially agreed with the underlying principles of antitrust laws, but that he came to the conclusion that they do more harm than good. Thomas Sowell argues that, even if a superior business drives out a competitor, it does not follow that competition has ended. In short, the financial demise of a competitor is not the same as getting rid of competition. The courts have long paid lip service to the distinction that economists make between competition a set of economic conditions a and existing competitors, though it is hard to see how much difference that has made in judicial decisions. Too often, it seems, if you have hurt competitors, then you have hurt competition, as far as the judges are concerned. Alan Greenspan argues that the very existence of antitrust laws discourages businessmen from some activities that might be socially useful out of fear that their business actions will be determined illegal and dismantled by government. In his essay entitled Antitrust, he says, "No one will ever know what new products, processes, machines, and cost-saving mergers failed to come into existence, killed by the Sherman Act before they were born. No one can ever compute the price that all of us have paid for that act which, by inducing less effective use of capital, has kept our standard of living lower than would otherwise have been possible." Those, like Greenspan, who oppose antitrust tend not to support competition as an end in itself but for its results low prices. As long as a monopoly is not a coercive monopoly where a firm is securely insulated from potential competition, it is argued that the firm must keep prices low in order to discourage competition from arising. Hence, legal action is uncalled for and wrongly harms the firm and consumers. Thomas Di Lorenzo, an adherent of the Austrian School of Economics, found that the trusts of the late 19th century were dropping their prices faster than the rest of the economy, and he holds that they were not monopolists at all. Ayn Rand, the American writer, provides a moral argument against antitrust laws. She holds that these laws in principle criminalize any person engaged in making a business successful, and, thus, are gross violations of their individual expectations. Such laissez-faire advocates suggest that only a coercive monopoly should be broken up, that is the persistent, exclusive control of a vitally needed resource, good, or service such that the community is at the mercy of the controller, and where there are no suppliers of the same or substitute goods to which the consumer can turn. In such a monopoly, the monopolist is able to make pricing and production decisions without an eye on competitive market forces and is able to curtail production to price gouge consumers. Laissez-faire advocates argue that such a monopoly can only come about through the use of physical coercion or fraudulent means by the corporation or by government intervention and that there is no case of a coercive monopoly ever existing that was not the result of government policies. Judge Robert Bork's writings on antitrust law, along with those of Richard Posner and other law and economics thinkers, were heavily influential in causing a shift in the U.S. Supreme Court's approach to antitrust laws since the 1970s. To be focused solely on what is best for the consumer rather than the company's practices. See also, Thurman Arnold, Commissioner Andrew L. Harris, Contestable Market, Dram Price Fixing, Duopoly, Economic Regulator, Government Monopoly, Limit Price, Market Anomaly, Monosony, Audio Liberalism, Patent Pool, SSNIP Test, EU Competition Law, Trade Practices Act 1974, Australian Antitrust Legislation, Notes. References, Texts, E. T. Sullivan, H. Hovenkamp and H. A. Schlansky, Antitrust Law, Policy and Procedure, Cases, Materials, Problems, C. Jagos, F. S. McKesney and T. A. Lambert, Antitrust Law, Interpretation and Implementation, P. Arida and L. Kaplow, Antitrust Analysis, Problems, texts, cases, theory. W. Adams and J. W. Brock, Antitrust Economics on Trial, Dialogue and New Learning, ISBN 0-691-00391-2. O. Black, Conceptual Foundations of Antitrust, R. H. Bork, The Antitrust Paradox, ISBN 0-02-904456-1. Choi, J. Pill. Recent Developments in Antitrust, Theory and Evidence. The MIT Press. ISBN 978-0-262-03356-5. Antonio Q. Sinotta, ed. Post-Chicago Developments in Antitrust Law, David S. Evans. Microsoft, Antitrust and the New Economy, Selected Essays, John E. Quarkar and Lawrence J. White, eds. The Antitrust Revolution, Economics, Competition, and Policy, R. A. Posner, Antitrust Law, An Economic Perspective, Articles, A. A. Bell, A Euro Corporate Powers as Powers in Trust, A Euro Unregistered Trademark, 44 Harvard Law Review 1049, A. A. Bell, The Theory of Enterprise Entity, 47, 3, Columbia Law Review 343, A. A. Bell, The Developing Law of Corporate Concentration, 19, 4, University of Chicago Law Review 639, A. A. Bell, Property, Production and Revolution 65, Columbia Law Review 1, Herbert Havenkamp, Chicago and Its Alternatives 6, Duke Law Journal 1014, A Euro 1029, B. Orbach and G. Campbell, The Antitrust Curse of Bigness, Southern California Law Review, R. Hofstadter, Whatever Happened to the Antitrust Movement? In the Paranoid Stalin American Politics and Other Essays, R. J. R. Peretz, Three Visions of Managed Competition, 1920, A Euro 1950-39, 1, Antitrust Bulletin 273, A Euro 287. Historical, Adolf Bell and Gardner Means, The Modern Corporation and Private Property, Louis Brandeis, The Curse of Bigness, Alfred Chandler, The Visible Hand, The Managerial Revolution in American Business, J. Dilem and A. Kahn, Fair Competition, The Law and Economics of Antitrust Policy, J. Dorfman, The Economic Mind in American Civilization 1865, A Euro 1918, T. Freyer, Regulating Big Business, Antitrust in Great Britain and America, 1880, A Euro 1990, W. Hamilton and I. Till, Antitrust in Action, W. Litwin, Law and Economic Policy in America, The Evolution of the Sherman Antitrust Act, E. Roswenk, ed. Roosevelt, Wilson and the Trusts. George Stigler, The Organization of Industry, G. Stocking and M. Watkins, Monopoly and Free Enterprise. H. Thoroughly, The Federal Antitrust Policy, Origination of an American Tradition, S. Webb and B. Webb, Industrial Democracy Part 3, CH 2, External Links, Government, United States Department of Justice Antitrust Division Homepage, United States Federal Trade Commission, Antitrust and Competition Division, Official European Union Antitrust Site, Canadian Competition Bureau, Other, Academic, Antitrust Policy as Corporate Welfare by Clyde Wayne Cruz, J.R.A. Euro. It is hoped that policymakers will come to recognize that government cannot protect the public from monopoly power, because it is the source of such power. Cornell University Review of Antitrust Law, The Protectionist Roots of Antitrust by Donald J. Baudria and Thomas J. DiLorenzo. Antitrust was a protectionist institution from the very beginning. There never was a golden age of antitrust besieged by rampant cartelization, Institute of Mergers, Acquisitions and Alliances M&A, an academic research institute on mergers and acquisitions, including antitrust issues, Consumer Institute for Antitrust Studies, Loyola University Chicago School of Law, Other, The Truth About the Robber Barons Criticizing Antitrust Law. Antitrust Definition by the Linux Information Project, Antitrust Review, a group blog, the American Antitrust Institute, International Competition Network, OECD Competition Homepage, German Antitrust Law, articles on Austrian Antitrust Law by Dorda Brugge-Jordis, Antitrust Laws Should Be Abolished by Edward W. Yunkins, February 19, 2000. Criticism of Antitrust by Alan Greenspan, Antitrust Law, Affirmative Action for Uncompetitive Businesses by Mark Schmidt, National Taxpayers Union Foundation, Policy Paper 132, December 11, 2000. The Antitrust Source, Monthly Analysis of Antitrust Issues by the American Bar Association, Antitrust by Frederick S. McKisney, The Antitrust Monitor, a law blog, Antitrust, Antitruth by Thomas DiLorenzo, June 1, 2000, Congress considers revoking health insurance and does a Euro unregistered trademark S exemption from antitrust laws, video report by Democracy Now!